ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Brugliana Show. I am Aaron True, 2010 MMA Reporter of the Year nominee, known for getting beat up by Ronda Rousey, Verdum, Cyborg, and many other people. Joined to my right by reoccurring guest star, soon-to-be union actor, from the hit show Kingdom, Jonathan King. Also, our third man in the booth, our audio-video producer. He's also a cage-side photographer, Adrian, the Mad Hatter, Gallegos. Tonight is going to be an incredible show. In 8 minutes from now, we have adult film star Jessa Rhodes. At 8:25 Pacific Standard Time, or in about 35 minutes, we have UFC fighter Jocelyn Liebarger. And in about 50 minutes, or at 8:45 PST, we have Georgie... What's his last name, John?
Karakanian.
We have Georgie Karakanian. I was going to say Karkanian, but... Anyways, Bellator co-main event. Incredible guy. Exciting guy. Three incredible guests. So if you want to skip forward to any of those, if you're listening to the entire show, it's going to be 8 minutes from now, Jessa Rhodes. It's going to be about 32 minutes from now, Jocelyn Liebarger. And about 45, 55 minutes from now, Georgie K. Ladies and gentlemen, this is The Brugliana Show. And if you are not familiar with us, we like to start every show by relaxing, taking a breather, calming down. So, Adrian always brings to us our beer of the week with our custom beer glasses from Edwards Industries. Adrian, what do you have for us this week?
So for this week, it's getting a little bit colder. You know, I thought I'd get some darker beers. This is a porter, and this is from Alaskan Brewing Company. They're one of the first companies or brewing companies that actually smoke their beer. So it's a pretty good beer. Here, let me open it for you guys.
They smoke their beer? That's Adrian, my kind of beer right there.
Adrian, what kind of coffee is that you made? It's not Caveman, is it?
No, it's not Caveman. Good. I think it's Kona.
Kona, whatever it is, I feel like that's some strong shit.
Dude, Kona's the only coffee I drink, I swear to God.
Good Lord.
It's pretty so amped good. Up, right?
Yeah, was that intro a little bit too edgy, too much, or was it okay?
It was good. No, it was perfect.
Right. Okay, yeah, I can't tell if I'm having a heart attack or if I'm on par.
Yeah, there's no rust on your chest, okay. So I'll tell you much.
So anyways, we've been gone for a few weeks working out different stuff, trying to find a home. Ladies and gentlemen, from now on, you're going to be able to find us at entimports.com. Entertainment and sports, entimports.com. You can find our videos there. Wow, Adrian, this is a dark brew. Looks incredible. Tell us about it, and then let's cheers and take a sip and tell us about it.
Back from the break, right? So, yeah, this is a porter, and, you know, just like all porters, they have a darker malt.
Damn, that's good.
And there's a little bit of, they age them in wood barrels. I'm not sure if they use wood chips on this one. I would assume cool. They put them in the same, in barrels. But a porter is just a darker beer. They use like a chocolate malt or different darker malts that they'll actually roast. And a stout is a type of porter. So porter is kind of a bigger category. But it's really good. It's a darker beer. It's good for when it's a little bit chilly outside. There's more of a sweet malt. And as you can tell, there's probably smoke in there as well.
Where can you find this and what is the pricing? And I'm not a beer guy, but this tastes incredible. I love it.
It's good, right? Yeah. It's kind of unique. The smoke, it really bounces out the bitterness, I believe.
Oh, yeah. You said it's from Alaska.
It's from Alaska. But you can find this at, you know, any craft beer liquor store. It's a good beer, like I said before.
Gold medal winner.
Yeah, it's one of the first ones to ever smoke their beer. And also, they only make this batch once a year. It's not an expensive bottle. I think it's $9.
That's my favorite part about the segment is that even though I'm not a beer connoisseur or drinker, that the one time a week I do get to taste a third of a beer, it's always something unique and interesting. Brewed once a year from an ice cave in Russia. It's always something awesome.
Yeah,
I try
to bring something, you know,
when
to the table.
I cover a lot of corporate events, and they recently had a beer tasting thing where at the open bar, they had four types of beers from local places in San Diego. One of them was Stone IPA. And I'm like, wait, hold on. I know this place. One, I've filmed a tour there, but also we've had that on our show. And the guy goes, what do you mean? You do beer tasting on your show? And I'm like, oh, it's a long story. We have these unique beers. And next thing you know, people are looking at me like I'm some kind of fancy beer guy.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, they think I'm Rick Budo over here.
Yeah. Yeah, I just, you know, listen to their show. We talk about beer every week. And, you know, I try to bring something unique.
It's a lot of fun.
You can't really, they don't make locally. A lot of the beers I've been bringing are from San Diego. So I try to, you know, I'd like to get some from the East Coast. So if anybody has any beer from the East Coast, I'm willing to sample and talk about it on the show. So,
nice. Oh, yeah, great idea. Also, we have on, again, in 4 minutes, Jessa Rhodes, adult film star. Before we get to there, speaking of people who could be because they have the body of an adult film star, ooh la la, ladies and gents, eat your hearts out. Sage Northcutt. Ooh, yummy. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about, right, Clint?
Yeah, he's a tall glass of water. I'll tell
yeah.
you.
So anyways, he just left TriStar. He's gone. His dad shows up, doesn't like what he sees, pulls him out. His dad's been in charge of his training, his diet, everything his whole life. Didn't like his, the way his endurance looked. Didn't like it, left. I have three options. You choose one. Okay, actually, I'm going to give you four. One, his dad's a complete control freak like Todd Marinovich and just has to micromanage the career. Two, he doesn't want to pay the 10% corner fee to Faraz. Three, he's sneaking PEDs in Sage's cereal or protein shakes without Sage knowing. Or D, none of the above.
I'm going with D, none of the above. I'm going with he has a huge distaste for poutine. You know, that banana. Or that
banana? It's potato.
No, the potato dish that they... He hates
poutine.
What the hell are you talking about? He hates poutine, and he can't live in a place where they serve Molson Golden and poutine. That's my answer, D. What the hell is he thinking? You going to leave Faraz? And his dad's running his career? How does someone... You know, how do you walk into a situation where you're not an expert and say, you know what, I'm the expert? It's just fucking retarded.
Well, there must have been something distinctively that he really did not like. So,
that's Jessa, I think. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Jessa Rhodes, I think, is calling in. She's a few minutes early, so we'll take a little bit early. But I think the thing with Sage is a little bit interesting because his father has controlled his career his entire life, and I think he's afraid to let go, and he just has to be in charge. And sometimes that can be a benefit. Sometimes it can be the biggest fault. You see this with a lot of pro athletes.
Sometimes that works in showbiz. Showbiz
stage
dad.
Father. Exactly. Yeah. That's what I wrote in my notes. I didn't know you know that term. I forgot you're a Hollywood guy.
Yeah, sometimes that works in Hollywood.
I actually have
that
in there. But
it doesn't often work. And I don't think it will ever work in professional sports. Like you said, A, Todd Marinovich. That's a good point. You know, it's a little bit different than that situation. His dad was kind of a real strict disciplinarian, but... yeah, I don't know. This is a bit odd. He seems out of his element.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have an absolute treat for you. Right now, we have on the 2015 XBiz Supporting Actors of the Year Award winner. We're talking about the one and only beautiful, stunning Jessa Rhodes. Jessa, welcome to the Bruliana Show. This is Aaron True, Jonathan King, and Adrian. How are you?
Hey, guys. I'm great. How are you?
We're doing amazing. Thank you so much for joining the show. I know I've... been hounding you down trying to get you on the show because we think that you look just like Paige VanZant. PVZ, Paige VanZant, the hottest thing in the UFC outside Rousey, but the hottest female probably. She's headlining her first ever main event, and I mean, you look just like her. Are we the only people to say this to you, or have you heard that you resemble her from other people?
No, you know, I actually get that a lot on Twitter. People will constantly tag like photos of me or her and get them kind of confused, so... The same thing happens with Jessa Hinton, though, evidently. The other day, they posted a flyer about me doing a store signing, and it was the wrong person, and I had to let them know that that wasn't me, so it happens quite
often. Has Paige ever contacted you or reached out, or have you ever interacted with her online?
No, I haven't. People, like, fans will tag us in the same post and stuff, and I'll just kind of, like, favorite it or be like, oh, that's funny, you know, because I hear it so often, and it's just kind of like, oh, you know.
All right.
I am a UFC fan myself, so...
All right, awesome. So you're a UFC fan. Tell us, have you ever trained in MMA or just taken a boxing class or kickboxing or jiu-jitsu?
You know, I haven't taken a professional one. My ex and I used to train together a little bit, but I'm looking back to going into it. Probably not right now or anytime soon because I just got my boobs done, so I'll probably wait another year to...
Okay.
So, you know, get back to that, but.
All right. Since you brought it up, speaking of getting your breast done, your augmentation, I'm sure they look amazing. Looking forward to checking that out sometime soon. But
thank you.
You're welcome. I do. I'm heavy into research, so I definitely did research last night. Looked at some of your videos. Incredible work. Incredible work.
Oh, you did your research?
Absolutely. How do you think I knew you were 2015? That's how I saw some of the newbie films. I saw some scenes you were nominated for AVN Best Girl Scene. I mean, amazing work. I had to do my work, but you're making me blush. But anyways,
he is actually blushing from you over the phone.
Well, because I don't want to go in this direction. I told her this isn't just going to be this kind of show. We're
no,
not gonna...
no worries. You know, it happens. It was funny. The other day, I was in a McDonald's drive-thru, and I had my dogs in the car, and it was pretty sad my dogs got recognized before I did, but I had my sunglasses on and stuff, and this kid was like, my husky Coda, like, kind of got in the front seat, and I was like, oh, you know, Coda, get in the back. I was talking to him by name, And the kid's like, he looks at me, he's like, are you who I think you are? And I just kind of give him this blank stare, and I was like, who do you think? And he goes, oh, you just answered. I go, homie, put the laptop down. For being a black kid, he turned pretty red pretty quick. It happens.
That's funny because John Jones just did an interview with Ariel Helwani, and he said, I'm blushing, you just can't tell. So that's funny you made a blushing
joke. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, well, so speaking of the breast augmentation, though, so if a fighter has a surgery or something, they might get out of shape. I know that you have an incredible body. What are you doing to maintain your conditioning while you're down with the surgery? How are you able to stay in shape?
Well, I'm sorry. My manager's sitting here and he's like, tell me just fuck a lot. Well, I have to say, unfortunately, I haven't been getting laid a lot because I actually have to be very careful with you know, doing that. So if I am having sex with anybody, I have to wear a sports bra still and kind of keep them like, so my friend's sitting here and he's like, yeah. No, you know, honestly, going into this, it was a really scary process for me because I do love to hit the gym. I actually recently got sober from some stuff, so hitting the gym for me was like, you know, my new addiction, and it was great. And this whole process has actually been really frustrating because I didn't expect it to be so terrifying because, you know, you have to realize, like, you can't take vitamins or anything for 2 weeks up until the surgery, and then you get the surgery done, and then you're, you know, sitting in bed for like a week. And of course, me being extremely independent, I was like driving by day three. And my manager's like, what the fuck are you doing? And, oh, sorry. And I don't know if I can help on this. But he's like,
yeah,
no, what are you doing?
Unrated.
Like, yeah, he's like, you know, don't, you know, what are you doing? Like, you're being too independent. Da, da, da. And it was just frustrating because the last couple weeks, like, of course, you know, you're coming off painkillers and all that stuff. And so having those chemicals running through my body and not being able to hit the gym, I'm like, you know, losing my mind. So honestly, no, I had this whole plan in my head to like eat healthy and, you know, take care of myself. And I have to say I did none of those things. Thank God for my metabolism because otherwise I'd be fucked. I'd be sitting here like eating like a whole cheesecake from Cheesecake Factory and like, you know, take out every day and stuff. So honestly, I have to say it was mostly just my dad's metabolism that I inherited.
Yeah, kind of got me through this. Just being young, so, I guess.
Yeah, so, you know what, it's not as bad as I thought it was going to be, so I'm thanking God I can hit the gym as of, like, next week, but it has been a kind of a terrifying process, but the worst of it is over, so that's great.
Okay, well, one of your great features is your beautiful hair, along with Paige VanZant as well, which is a huge controversy lately, her hair. She agreed. She agreed to shave her head for charity if a certain amount of money was raised or if something happened, or I forgot the stipulations. I don't want to misspeak and then get in trouble, but pretty much she agreed to shave her head for charity and then decided not to do it. If you ever gave your word to do something as drastic as that and then actually got called on it, would you go through with it and do it even though it might hurt your career to be a person of your word? Or would you just say, oh, well, fuck it, my manager said no? What's more important to you?
You know what? If they were truly a good management group, they would encourage her to go through with what she promised the public. And I'm sorry, but that's fucked up of her to do that. I don't care if she hears this or not. I think that's a really rookie move, and I think that's really messed up because people are donating their time and their money. And for something that's so, you know, that, like, people take that seriously. I would take that seriously. I'm sorry. If you didn't feel like you could go through with it, that's something that you shouldn't have promised. People have already donated money to, you know, have this happen, and that's just a messed up thing to do. Like, I personally, I used to have an email where people could contact me and send in donations for St. Jude. And I would send out posters and, you know, thank you stuff, like, you know, like whether it was like panties or sign or this or that or whatever. And I remember, like, I would get really down on myself if I didn't have time to do it, and I would send them more stuff to try to make up for it. That's just, you know, that's a part of being a good, you know, business person is that's your brand. And I'm sorry, but she's going to fuck herself over in the end because the second I heard that, I was no longer a fan.
Wow, so I was going to ask you, would you do a parody porn video with PVZ, like one of the Ronda Arouse Me ones like Joanna Angel did, so you would no longer be interested in doing a Paige VanZant porno parody?
You know, I might, but that's because I'm getting paid for it, and that's my job.
So what do you think your name would be? What would you, you know how they always have to put a parody on the name? What would you suggest the parody be for your name?
My manager goes, Paige, no pants.
I like it.
That's
okay.
Awesome.
Very nice. And that's my that's my co-host, Jonathan King. Jonathan, do you have any questions for the lovely Jessa Rhodes?
Hey, Jonathan, what's up?
How are you? You touched earlier on your surgery. I was just wondering, you know, and I'm sure your fans are listening to and they're wondering, where did you go from and where did you end up at with that surgery? I guess
so
is the way
I
to go delicately.
No, not at all. You can Google it. It's fine. I'm a pretty open book. I was a 32B and I went to a 32D. They're looking pretty awesome. I'm pretty stoked about it right now. My doctor looks great. And,
I can't breathe.
I did a...
Aaron went from blushing to choking.
I can't breathe.
You know, I do that on a daily basis. It just depends on what you're choking on, but, you know. Oh my gosh!
I just got that. Why am I always the butt from every time we have an adult star on? I'm the butt of a homosexual joke every time.
The butt?
Oh my gosh! You guys are assholes.
Is that a pumping sound out of the table that I'm hearing? What is that?
Oh, what?
Are you guys playing
footsie?
What's going on?
Oh,
I don't know.
Oh man, Adrian, I don't know.
I'm producing over here.
Yeah,
I mean, the best way is, you know, it sounds like you're going out that shit dry. It's probably, you know, something.
Oh, my gosh. All right, well, yeah, so, Jessa, I wanted to ask you, I was doing some research. Do you have your own website, or are you a contract girl? For a video company? Like, where can we find you? Like, where's the best place
to
find
some more
work?
Research.
Yeah.
Research.
Well, no. I mean, if people want to support you. Like, if people want to support
you.
No, we're trying to promote your business. I want to know if people...
She walked in with your cock in your hand. I'm just researching, Mom. Okay.
Oh, man. I didn't want that to get out.
Maybe a condom?
Not blessed.
You need some Crisco?
Oh, man. If you were at the pre-production meeting, you would know that this is a little too close to home.
He dry dogs it.
We're working on my site right now. I've been in the business 3 years, and I've still just been... It's not necessarily me being lazy. It's probably like 10% of that. It's just that I don't really, up until this point, I haven't really felt the need to like shoot content and stuff. I've just been so busy with everything else and I'm teaching dancing all the time. So it's kind of, you know, it's hard to keep up on that. So I've tried to kind of switch it off so I can really, make that a priority for the fans. Cause you know, I don't want to start a website and then have them, you know, not go back to it. So I'm kind of holding off on that. We're working on it right now. So I'm going to guess by, you know, early spring. Everything should be up and running. We don't have the site yet. We're still working on some trademarking issues. But as of right now, I've got, you know, basically Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Facebook. It's all under Miss Jessa Rose, MISSJESSARCHOTES. So all of the fans can find me on there, and I'm pretty responsive with my fans. So, you know, it's cool. I love talking to them. It's great. Actually, I had a fan get a tattoo the other day of something that I had said to him, and it was really cool to see that, you know, that I had that kind of impact on him that was really cool to see. But I love talking to my fans. So, yeah, if they want to, they can reach out to me on there.
Can I ask you a question? Let me get your prediction for the fight. Are you a fan of now Thug Rose or PVZ? Who are you predicting to win the fight? Because this is,
you know,
this
I
is a big a big chance, or I mean a big test for
Paige. I've been a pretty bad fan recently. I haven't really been keeping up on the UFC. I just watched the Frankie Edgar fight and stuff, and I was pretty disappointed in that. I kind of knew he wasn't going to win, but... No, when it comes to that, you know, I've actually never seen Paige fight, so I guess I'll have to do some research before that and see where I feel is a better fighter. But I will say, hands down, I'm a huge Rousey fan, so I was pretty bummed out that I found out that she got knocked out. I was pissed because I was at my house, and fuck my Warner cable, can I just say that?
Of course.
I ordered the fight, and I'm at my house getting ready to watch it, and it was nothing but a blank screen. And then I found out later she got, you know, her face beat, and so I was like, God damn it, I was so freaking pissed, man. Yeah, but no, you know, and I was a huge John Jones fan before that, but after that, he pulled in Vegas. He's a pretty shitty person in my book, so.
You mean the hit and run?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he's he just announced that he's, I think, coming back to fight in April. But I believe my co-host...
Yeah,
Adrian has a question for you. My co-host Adrian has a question for you.
I just have a quick question.
Yeah, go for it.
If you wanted to have a private training session with any UFC fighter, who would it be?
Oof.
And what would you train? Stand up or grappling?
You know, BJ Penn is pretty dope. I like BJ Penn, but I'd probably, for the sake of it, definitely Rousey. Rousey's pretty badass.
Sweet.
Okay. And if you need help with your research, your UFC research, Aaron can help you.
Anthony Pettis is pretty, he's a freaking monster. He's he's known for those Matrix kicks and shit, so that's pretty badass. So, I don't know, it'd probably be a toss-up between Rousey and Pettis.
Anthony Pettis has a, I think he has a longtime girlfriend, but let's pretend he was single. Would you be down to get down with Anthony Pettis for Showtime?
A little bit of Showtime.
Would you be down to get down with Showtime with Anthony Pettis, Showtime Pettis?
Maybe. I don't know.
All right. Okay. And then last thing before we let you go, I have one last question for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Why do you think men find powerful women sexy? Because all these guys think like Paige and all the other fighters like Ronda are hot. What is it about women, like powerful women, do you think that men find sexy?
They're confident.
Yeah, I'm not a man, so I can't really answer that question, but I know from a woman's perspective, like, yeah, it's empowering. Like, it's empowering to see any kind of person who has, you know, that amount of power and stability and stuff. But for me, it's my biggest turn on, especially with a guy, is like seeing somebody who's confident and powerful but still humble. So for me, like, when it comes to those fighters, it's kind of iffy. Like, you could be, you know, you just have to be a cool person. But
that's me minus a fighter. That's me.
Yeah, you're describing Aaron. Yeah. Like
humble but confident. That's about it, but...
And you're both researchers,
yes,
you know?
Yes,
God, this is a match made.
I mean,
ahead.
I guess at the end of the day, if you're that kind of guy, every king needs his queen, so...
There you go.
Sounds good. All right, well, Jessa, thank you so much for being on the show. We really appreciate it. Is there anything else you want to tell us about where we can find you, whether or not it's anything that we can get product-wise, or basically you told us Twitter and Instagram and stuff, but do you, you know, like, when you have new videos coming out or anything else you want to promote? We just want to
I'm right now, because of the, you know, the surgery and stuff, I'm going to take a little bit of time off and decide who I want to shoot for coming back. I'm going to do, you know, the awards and stuff, and then I'm probably going to come back to shooting in February. But as of right now, I'm going to be on the road dancing. So, you know, they can follow me on Twitter and find those dates. So I'm going to be in Baltimore and Oklahoma City, and then Pittsburgh and possibly San Antonio and a couple other places in the next couple months. So if they want to come out and see me and get an autograph, lap dance, you know, whatever.
Okay. I know your manager's there. Tell him I'm taking only 3.5%. He can keep the rest. You need to get booked in Vegas next week during Paige's fight.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Yes.
Why aren't you? You should. Know, that would be amazing. Wouldn't that be cool?
Paige No Pants live.
Yes.
You know, we might come out just for that, because we have a couple of friends in Vegas who
Oh my gosh.
We'll see.
Christy Mack used to go to the fights, and that's how she got kind of big in the MMA community, because she would go and they would put her on TV just because it's a hot chick, you know, in the crowd, and like, oh, Christy Mack. I mean, if you were there during a Paige fight, they'd be like, ladies and gentlemen in the crowd, oh my God, can you believe it? Jessa Rhodes, oh my gosh, everyone, the lady everyone thinks looks like Paige. Good Lord, is she beautiful.
The only thing I'm going to say about Christy Mack is she should probably stay as far away from anything MMA associated as possible.
Yeah, I was going to say that didn't work out too well.
I was just referencing. All right, well, Jessa, thank you so much for your time. You've been a lovely guest. We had an amazing time. Ladies and gentlemen.
You guys are awesome.
Jessa Rhodes.
Oh, man. Thank you so much.
Have a good night, guys. I'm going to go get drunk.
Woo! Awesome. Woo!
Have a good one.
Thanks.
Dude, she's fun.
Yeah, that was amazing. That was a lot of fun. I had a great time.
She's a little cool. She's a little ball of energy, huh?
Yeah, she has more energy than we do. We drank a couple cups of coffee already.
Wow. Yeah, that was great. That was a lot of fun. That was pretty cool. I didn't know she was a fan of the UFC, but now she's not a fan of Paige because of the hair thing, and she did know about that. Well, that's pretty cool.
That pisses people off, man. When
not cool that she's not a fan, but cool that she did. You know, she's up to date.
One thing that relates with everybody, no matter where you are in society, is being a person of your word. It relates to every aspect of the fucking.
Because no matter what amount of money you have, education you have, societal cultural differences, that's one thing.
You could be a rich man, but if you don't do what you say you're going to do, you can never get your word back. Never, it's gone. You know.
Man, that was a lot of fun. That was a great interview. That was a lot of fun.
She's good people. And the fact that she, real quick with the Paige No Pants, I like that.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I was surprised she knew so much about MMA. I mean, she mentioned BJ Penn and Pettis. I mean,
that's
surprising.
And Ronda, she was up to date even on the Holly fight, and she said how the cable went out. She wanted to watch it.
As Reebok would call him, I believe that was the one I was trying to think
Pettis?
Of. Yes, Anthony the Mauler. Pettis.
No, you got it.
Yes, I swear to God, that was what Reebok put on their website.
Are they doing that on purpose?
I don't know.
I honestly think that their campaign is that's the way they're getting attention. Is they're like, yeah, if we fuck this up, it will get more attention than doing a real campaign.
You know that one hand raised in the back of the meeting. They're like, what do we do? I need ideas. And one guy was like,
Anderson Aldo.
I have one. why don't we just intentionally fuck up some of the jerseys? Gold!
Yeah. That is brilliant.
I wish I would have bought that shirt because that's going to be a collector's, right? I mean, I don't know if I want to spend...
Oh, I doubt they produced 95. And sold them.
No, they sold them. The guy actually got one in Brazil.
Are you serious?
Yeah, Anderson Aldo one?
Yeah, yeah.
No.
That's when they found out about
that
it.
That got all the way to the store?
No, that got to someone's hands. That got to consumer. That got to a consumer.
Yeah, because that's what they. I'm pretty sure that's how they found out. Was one of the guys from Brazil took a picture of it.
We gotta check eBay and see if any of those are available. Dude, I know that would be awesome.
Well, the one I remember the most is Gilbert. What is it?
Oh, Gibbler.
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 And yeah. Mark Hughes. Matt. Yeah. Technically, he was, I think, in the UFC. Matt Hughes' twin brother.
Yeah, he had one fight.
Yeah,
didn't he?
And then Lyoto. God, there was like Shogun. Mauricio, like Lyoto, Mauricio, Machida, or something like that.
That's so bad. They're obvious. They don't fuck up NFL jerseys. I don't see him spelling Tom Brady's name wrong. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. And isn't that Reebok as well?
Yeah. It's like, come on, guys, get your shit together.
Yeah. And what do you guys think of, speaking of Reebok and sponsorship, Benson Henderson? What do you get? $10,000?
Smart move, man.
But what do you get? $10,000?
Yeah, but the move to test the market is really smart. You know,
but I think from Reebok, his last fight, he got $10,000 for the main event in Korea.
And,
a guy like that who basically was Dethrone's main guy, he's making big money in sponsors. I guarantee a guy like that makes $100,000 at least a fight in sponsors.
If I'm Benson Henderson, I sign with Ryzen. I make $150,000 a fight, I beat tomato cans for 5 years.
What was that Korean company?
The Korean company.
Not ONE FC.
That's the other one.
Something FC.
Yeah, that's the one that's offering them
fight
a
FC
shitload of money.
They're
KSW
saying 200
or something like that.
Well, no, $200,000 a fight.
Well,
Ryzen, we're going to have King Mo on in a couple of weeks. He's fighting the heavyweight tournament. Did you see, why are they talking about Fedor versus Antonio Silva? And did Silva get cut by the UFC?
We don't know. We should have researched before we started this conversation.
It was a troll.
It's probably another Antonio Silva. It's Oswerio Silva.
No. It was Bigfoot. It wasn't the freaking huge ass. Because it's a rematch. Yeah. You know Giant Silva, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
What I was going to say about Benson is his last fight, he only made 45 and 45.
No, you're kidding.
And no, I'm not kidding.
As a former champ?
As a former champ. Wow. That's
I thought he would be at like... No, God, at least 125 something.
You know, he's probably on another contract after that he lost the title.
Gosh.
Because that's
a shame.
Yeah. I mean, it's better than Nate Diaz money, but it's still...
What's Nate Diaz making?
Fights ago, he made 16 and 16.
But then since then, he's had two big fights, and he has a big one coming up, Michael Johnson. Yeah. Not a big name, but a big fight.
But a guy that was on the same card, Gray Maynard, had one less fight than Diaz did in the UFC at that point, and he made like 32 and 32.
And then just before we move on from this, I mean, it's pretty clear, like, I don't have a chance with Jessa, right?
No.
Okay, yeah, I didn't think so.
But it's fun.
I'm kidding, but you know how I always say that after every interview, and you guys say, you say that every time.
It's fun to think you might.
No, this time I knew I didn't, but I still had a great time.
Yeah. She's a lot of fun, too, man. She's cool.
She was, that was a great interview, man. I had a freaking blast. A blast. And we still have Jocelyn Liebarger coming up, who is a freaking blast, too. She's so awesome. And then her and I'm jealous because she has the best damn hair ever. She's obviously alternative lifestyle, likes girls, but is kind of like the boy in the relationship, I think, even though she's feminine and cute. Her hair is amazing. It's amazing. And I always want to know what hair product she uses.
Correction. He made 50 to show, 50 to win, and then he only made $15,000 from Reebok, which is still not that much from the sponsorship.
Wow, so he made 115 total.
Yeah,
total.
What was with that like retarded half...
Potato.
That half potato taking the gloves off in the middle of the cage.
Who, Benson?
Yeah.
I know, that was weird because
put him down and picked him up and waved.
Maybe it was
like,
to symbolize his last UFC fight or who knows.
Basically, he went like this. I'm going to make a statement that really states nothing.
Yeah, I'm going to bluff. What did you think about the John Jones interview that just came out where he's walking with Ariel Helwani, the walk in the park, Ariel's classic style where mayhem walk in the park, John Jones, his damage control. Hey, if you want some damage control, we can take a walk in the park and film an interview.
Makes him look natural.
Yeah, I'm hating, but it was a great interview.
We did it with Rampage as well.
Ariel's a great guy. Yes, in Tokyo. That was a great one.
That was actually a good one.
They're all good. He does good work. We're just being jerks to him.
Without getting into specifics, I've been around a lot of people that have fucked their lives up many, many times. And the one thing that you can tell is...
Including yourself.
Oh, yeah. the thing that I got out of that interview is John Jones hasn't learned the lesson yet.
No.
No. He tried cocaine one time the time he got caught. He used to be addicted. Addicts, they say you're never recovered. Used to be addicted 3 months ago. Used to be. Plus, and it's none of my business anyway, his personal life, so I'm not calling him out. He could be telling the truth. But the point is, he was... and then the way he introduced himself, any of you ever heard of me? I'm eight-time world champion, UFC champion. Yeah, I beat people up for a living. I'm a certified badass. Come on, man. You're talking to kids. You're talking to kids at community service. Get a grip, son. He called me son on video one time. You calling me son? How about you, son? Get a grip, son.
John Jones, to me, Punk. Is a guy that is really uncomfortable in his own skin.
This coffee has got me on a fucking good one. And fucking Punk Jones. Yeah. I'll go to the new Albuquerque John Winklejohn right now and fucking teep kick your ass in the freaking thigh.
Even with your big muscles. Even with your big muscles.
I'm not scared of that
guy. What do you think of his
We're kidding. What do you think I'm a huge fan of them.
His new physique. I mean, he looks
incredible.
Oh, he looks great.
He looks great.
And he's going to be a champion.
He's no Sage Northcutt or Tim Kennedy.
Oh, no. I mean, that guy's just phenomenal.
Speaking of which, Hunting Hitler is the coolest show ever.
Yeah, oh, God, yes.
It's amazing. Did you see the new episode last night?
Yes.
They just found the U-boat, of course, at the end. Oh, you didn't see the very end?
Don't ruin anything because I'm like,
well, they may not have
behind.
Found a U-boat. Okay. It's not confirmed.
Shut up, Dick.
But they got radar.
Did they find the tunnel?
Yes, they confirmed.
The tunnel?
From the airport, yes.
I started watching, like the first episode, and I was like, this is silly. There's no Hitler there.
No.
But like 15 minutes into it, I was like, I gotta watch. I can't close my eyes. This is amazing.
The reason I love it is they don't go into it assuming Hitler did escape. They said we're gonna see if it happened.
Yeah.
So
it's even possible.
Yeah, but the point is they're not going in conspiracy style Eddie Bravo like, dude, for sure this happened. Oh my God. Hitler, for sure, he was in the U-boats, bro. And you don't even know.
And they say the truth.
Swedish eugenics. Yeah. We got to get Eddie on for EBI. I love Eddie.
They're not
EBI
like,
this week, I think, by the way.
They're not like the hunting Bigfoot people, which, by the way, we have to do an episode
We need to get
about.
Bobo on it. That guy's the biggest stoner in the world, I swear to God.
You hear like an acorn fall from a tree, and it's like, that was definitely a squatch. Was a squatch.
He's like knocking on a tree. You hear that knock? All right, Adrian, let me give you the call-in number for Jocelyn.
What time she's coming?
2 minutes. We're going to call her.
Okay.
But yeah, that's the good thing about the Tim Kennedy show is like they say, we thought this was something, but it's not. It's nothing.
Tim Kennedy, he's pretty badass. And then they have that guy from the U.S. Marshall show.
He's a natural. I like Tim Kennedy on the show. He was very, you know.
I think he's really now I know why he has no interest in fighting soon.
Oh, yeah. We have to do the Tim Kennedy public service announcement too.
Which is?
Don't buy his Reebok kit. If it's made available, Tim Kennedy does not want you to buy his Reebok kit.
Tim Hunting Hitler Kennedy. That'd be awesome.
Don't. If you're thinking about it, no, he doesn't even want you to think about it, right? He said don't even think about it. So don't. If you're thinking about it, just stop and think about something else immediately. Okay? Good.
Thank you for that that PSA. Yeah. Hopefully we still have listeners. Sorry if my mic keeps tilting moving, so I'm sorry if I'm going in and out. So I think we're going to bring on Jocelyn Liebarger. This is pretty cool. Check this out. She just recently recently took on Zola Frosto, who has fought several people in the UFC. She's like no joke at all.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
can you talk about her real quick while I just look up something?
Well, Frosto was very highly claimed. She was touted. She's fought in Bellator. She's fought all over. She trains with Jurgel. And she's a legit badass. Liebarger came into that fight an underdog and pieced her apart for five rounds. Oh my God! It was a work of art to watch somebody completely not go for the knockout at all, but to paint a five round masterpiece like she did. It was like an old school boxing fight in the mold of Sugar Ray Leonard type stuff. It was just beautiful.
And that's what has me wondering. Is she going to go for the upset again and make it happen? Will lightning strike twice? Excuse me. Will lightning strike twice? Ladies and gentlemen, we have on someone making their UFC debut at UFC 194, the current RFA champion, 6-1 as a pro. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend, Jocelyn Liebarger. Jocelyn, how are you? Welcome to the show.
Aaron True, come on now. You know I got married. It's Jocelyn Jones Liebarger.
Oh, man. Let me do it again then real quick. Ladies and gentlemen, Jocelyn Jones Liebarger. And I did actually tell my co-host that you are married, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
So I knew. Shout out to Mrs. Jones, by the way. Jocelyn, this is incredible. In the past month, you didn't even really have time to celebrate. you had probably one of the biggest upsets in women's MMA just because people underestimate you, not because there's anything against you, but you went into it as a huge underdog. An incredible performance against Zoyla Frosto. Incredible. Become the RFA champ. Then everyone's lobbying for you to go to the UFC. All of a sudden, there's an injury. No one else steps up. Boom. You're in. So are you still in shape? How are you feeling? Are you ready to, as the underdog, upset again?
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm in shape. You know, I had a gut feeling that, you know, after my performance and winning, that the call can come anytime. And, you know, when Sean Shelby calls you, you don't want to say no because you're not going to make weight or you're not training because they're never going to call you again. So, you know, John Crouch and everybody at the MMA lab, I was right back to work, you know, after winning the belt. And, you know, I'm always fight ready and to take a fight, you know, 2.5 weeks. Notice to make my UFC debut on this kind of card. Like, I'm super excited.
When I met you in 2010, maybe even 2009, I think 2010 though, you even said back then your goal is you want to fight in the UFC, you know, even though they don't have a women's division at the time. You still wanted to fight. So what did it feel like to finally get that call? Like, how crazy was it?
Man, when Sean called me on Tuesday, I just started crying. And he was laughing at me, but I couldn't help it. Like, I was just crying because I was so happy that the emotions were just running through me, and it was just, it's crazy. Like, the hard work pays off, but the hard work's not going to stop now because I don't want to be known just for making it. I actually want to go in. A lot of these girls, a lot of them I can beat, you know, and I want to go in there and make some noise.
That's what I was going to say. You're the RFA champ 6-1. If you beat someone who's undefeated, like Tisha, who's 6-0, you know, she's pretty much a title contender. Do you pretty much then unify the belt? I know you probably won't keep the RFA one, but do you pretty much step right into a title shot? Because everyone else is either injured, has been beaten by the champ, and you'll be 7-1 with a huge victory over someone who's undefeated in the UFC.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't even processed that yet because I have, you know, Tisha on my mind. But, you know, depending on my performance, you never know what they'll do. But I mean, when her hand gets better, because I think the champ broke her hand or something in the last fight. I mean, I'll fight anybody, anytime, anywhere.
Jocelyn, you come from a pretty cerebral camp. Game planning is very important, as evident in your last fight. We were just talking about it. That was an absolute masterpiece that you painted, a bloody canvas. For 5 rounds, you pieced apart this poor girl. What's the game plan, without getting into too much detail? Is the game plan pretty much the same thing going in against Tisha Torres? Or do the people at the lab have you changing everything up and adapting to the specific opponent?
I mean, we changed a few things, I won't say, but that's what kind of fighter I am. I like to push the pace. I like for my opponent's back to be on the cage, and I want to control the tempo. I want to know when we're going to the ground, when we're standing. But, you know, I do like to stand, but I haven't even really got to showcase my wrestling nor jiu-jitsu. You know, in the last fight, I had a few takedowns, you know, took her back, body triangle, stuff like that, and I felt good. But, yeah, I mean, there is going to come a time where I'm going to showcase, you know, the rest of my skills. People just keep talking about my hands, and people are saying I don't throw kicks, but we had a game plan not to throw kicks. You know, I didn't want to give her the space so Zoyla can throw her kicks. So that's why I was really crowding her, you know. You know, people don't understand that, but we have a great team, you know, under John Crouch at the lab.
That's what I was going to ask you. I think, aren't you training with Benson, Joe Riggs, and other UFC fighters? Like, it's a really strong camp. So tell us about your gym and your team.
Yeah, I mean, we practice 2 times a day, and it's always, you know, the pros together. I mean, from our team, we have, like, 19 UFC fighters on the roster. It's pretty crazy. But, yeah, I mean, Joe Riggs was with me this morning, did some of my rounds with Yatsen Meza. You know, Efren Escondero was back in the gym today. I had some rounds with Lauren Murphy today. I mean, the list goes on. But the cool thing is it's always all of us together pushing each other. And, you know, making my UFC debut, I've had, you know, all of the guys in my corner and even Lauren, and they've all been giving me, you know, great advice.
All right, well, let me ask you a question, and take this as a friend, but I feel like this possibly is happening. I think they're sending you in as a sacrificial lamb. First they did it at RFA. They said, no way can she beat Zola. This is going to be Zola's big comeback. We can put her back as champion. Boom, you spoiled that party big time. Now they're saying Tisha, you know, title contender. Who can we throw in last minute? Same situation again. I think you're going to upset and spoil the party again. Do you go in there with a bit of a chip on your shoulder thinking that they're sending you in there to lose?
Yeah.
And they're completely underestimating you. Does that give you any added motivation? Or do you feel that that's not accurate?
No, I feel that's right. A lot of people are thinking that, and that's what a lot of people did, you know, the last fight. But it doesn't add fuel because the fuel's already there. Like, I want to win. Like, this is my job. And to stay on top and keep doing well at my job, I have to keep winning, you know, to make money for my family, to do what I love. And, you know, I'm a competitor. I have a lot of respect. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry to cut you off, but I was going to say, that's what I've noticed is when you first came in the scene, it's always the same with everyone. You know, you got to have some kind of gimmick or shtick to get your name out. You know, you were one of the twins. You were one of the twins. You had the older sister, adult star. You had these things, and you were learning and developing as a fighter. Now you're 6-1. It's like now you're just a fighter. You know, it's you know, when I was telling Adrian today, my co-host, he goes, hold on, isn't she the one with the twin? I'm like, yes, that's Jocelyn Liebarg. And he's like, oh, yeah, I know who she is. So what does it feel like? Do you feel like you're finally getting validation as Jocelyn Jones Liebarger as an individual and getting respect for your skills?
Oh, yes, yes. You know, a big thing when I went to the lab, and I've been there almost 4 years now, is John Crouch really says substance over style. Forget all the, you know, the flash, the media stuff, the... just all of that, like, fake stuff. Like, you got to be winning. You got to work hard in the gym. Like, hard work pays off, and that's what's going to get you. Not the other stuff. Not the sexy pictures half naked on Instagram. Like, none of that BS. Like, you got to go in there, and you got to take care of it in the cage.
Yeah, if you're winning, then it doesn't matter what you look like, what you do. If you're winning, that's what happens.
I have a question for you. I would love to get your perspective from another fighter in a similar division, not the same division, but the Ronda Rousey-Holly Holm fight. How did you break that fight down, and what do you think Ronda Rousey's – what's next for her? I'm curious to get your perspective.
I think Ronda's going to be back. I mean, she's one of the thanks to her, it's because we're in the UFC, bottom line. You know, I have so much respect for her. She just got beat that night, you know, and I don't know if she was expecting it or thought it would go a different way, but for sure, 100%, I see her coming back. I see her, you know, being, you know, back on top again, and we'll see how it plays out, but she's a true competitor.
All right, and, excuse me, and then Jocelyn, you know, it's been a long road from your amateur career to where you are now. Tell us, how have you progressed and become a complete fighter? I know you said you were known for your hands, but you have wrestling to display. How did your journey into martial arts start? Because I remember you telling me the story, but I can't exactly remember.
Yeah, honestly, I mean, after going to Jill's second amateur fight, that's when I started doing it, you know, back in, you know, in Orange County with Jeff Morgan and Jeremiah with all those boys. But, you know, it's really when I moved here to Arizona and started training at the lab, that's when I just really, you know, bit down and went 100% full throttle. This is what I'm going to do. And it's going pretty well. But you also have to have that support system, you know. And my support system at home, you know, my wife Jana, our stepdaughters, like, I'm truly blessed, you know, and if you didn't have that, it's going to make it harder, but I mean, it can be done, but I have to thank everybody, you know, at the lab and John Crouch for where I'm at.
I'm going to have a Joe Rogan moment. I shed a tear. I shed a damn tear, and I cried. When you won the RFA championship, your sister posted a video from the bar, and your family was going crazy. They had all the bar TVs on your fight. That was incredible, yeah. And I was going to mention that about your family. They're such a huge support system, and it must be amazing to know that they have your back and to go into the cage with their support.
Yeah, you know that. You pretty much met them all. You know that. You know they were always at all the amateur fights. We're in Vegas at Tough Enough and stuff like that. But you know, it's crazy how it's full circle now, and here we are talking again.
UFC 194, Tisha Torres is your opponent. Real quick, tell me what you find a strength of hers and what you find a weakness of hers, something that you might be able to exploit.
Oh, a few weaknesses. She's not known, really for her cardio, but, I mean, we'll see this time. She's been training for a while because she's known about this bike. As far as, she likes to throw and move, but, the key is, you just have to push the pace on her. I think it's going to be a good fight. You know, she's going to come in shape, and we'll see if we stand and bang, or if she just wants to take me down. That usually tends. What happens is when you start getting hit in the face, when you don't like getting hit, and you go for the takedown. So I'm excited.
She's 6-0 with all of her wins by decision. 7-0 as an amateur, 5 of those wins by decision. So she's going to try to grind you out. She's going to go in there. So are you going to be prepared to grind it out with her and give us your prediction for the outcome of the fight?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I see myself winning by decision. That's what I like to do, is grind it out. Like, if I get you against the fence, you're not going to get off.
All right. Oh, sorry to cut you off.
No, you're fine.
Last thing, okay, I was telling my co-host, I was saying how I'm still pissed off even thinking about it. I'm so mad about your hair for some reason because I wish I had it. Let me ask you, who has, now that you're in the UFC, who has the best hair in the UFC? Jocelyn Jones Liebarger or Sage Northcutt?
Mine!
I gotta agree.
Okay, so you're going on record saying you have better hair than Sage.
Yeah, he needs to blow dry it more. He used too much product, so if you touch it, it probably feels really hard.
Is that what I'm doing wrong? I gotta use a blow dryer?
Yes!
I don't know that trick.
Never.
I really don't know that trick. I just use like goopy stuff.
No, and hair product, less is more.
Okay. All right.
All right, Jocelyn, is there anything you want to promote, or where can we find you? Do you have a website? We have your Twitter address up on the screen, but do you have a website or any people? I know, obviously, your sponsor is Reebok. I'm sure you're thrilled about that, but do you have any people that are helping you along the way that can't be in the cage?
Yeah, I want to thank Cancer Treatment Centers of America. You guys rock. You guys know that. But also everybody at the MMA Lab. My whole team, and my wife, Shanna.
All right. Well, Jocelyn, thank you so much for short notice, for taking the time to chat with us. And, I mean, this is incredible. I remember watching her at Tough Enough Amateur Fighting Championships in Vegas. What's up, Jeff? Now to UFC 194, freaking Conor McGregor versus Aldo. This is incredible. I'm so happy for you. I'm so proud of you. It's kind of a rocky moment watching someone literally go up the ranks to the big show. This is great, and we wish you nothing but continued success, and we'll be rooting for you every step of the way.
Let me say something real quick, Aaron. Sure. I remember my amateur debut, and then after I weighed in, we had to go over an interview with you, and I looked at you, and I was like, oh my God, I've always wanted to talk to you.
Thank you for saying that, because no one ever believes it when I tell them about that one moment.
So you're the one.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Jocelyn. Ladies and gentlemen, Jocelyn Jones Liebarger making her debut, UFC 194.
Awesome job, man.
Thank you, Jocelyn.
She's a tough girl, man. I tell you what, I wasn't sold on her. Like you said, she started off one of the twins. There was kind of a gimmick towards it. And, she was one of my early friends on Facebook when I first moved out here. So I've been following her career from the beginning, pretty much. And I wasn't sold on her. And then I watched that fight. And that was one of the top five.
That was a prize fight, dare I say.
Yeah, one of the top five female fights that I've seen in the past 3 years.
Jeez. And the hype on Twitter, like social media, even though she's had like 12, 13, 14, however many fights, that's her coming out party. Yeah, it was on Access TV.
And Zola is
a name brand prize fighter.
That's the point I was just going to make, too. It always takes two to tango. So even though Zoila lost, she was given as good as she was getting in that fight, man. She was throwing, and she
you
made
let your guard down for one second against Zoila, she'll land a haymaker. Oh, she'll drop your ass.
Yeah. Yeah. It was such an entertaining fight. Yeah. Even though it was a one-sided win, it wasn't, unentertaining.
That's not easy.
You know,
it was to beat someone
fight.
Up for 25 minutes. Oh, that's
no.
not easy.
That's no. tough. Yeah.
To stay sharp, like you said. I mean, that was when, like you said, I was like, "Damn, her technique looks good."
And you can see it. You can you see it more in boxing than you do in MMA. You see it in MMA more on the undercards where someone gets rocked and the guy will get too overly aggressive, mm-hmm. and he'll follow him in and he'll get sweeped or.
Exactly.
Not necessarily lose the fight, but lose the opportunity.
Leave yourself open
for the
to
win.
A big, right.
yeah.
a
and
big counter.
She didn't do that. She was content to say, "I'm gonna for 15 minutes. I'm gonna fucking punch your face, or 25 minutes actually."
Yeah, and it was a fun fight
yeah.
to watch.
Yeah, it was great.
That's awesome. Yeah, to see her make it to the UFC, and that was really cool when she said that nice thing about me at the end. You know, I like that type of stuff.
How much
know.
Did you pay her for that?
Yeah, I know.
None.
Right?
Are you sponsoring it?
I wish that'd be cool. Well, yeah. So, man, that's a tough fight against Tisha. Tough fight. Wouldn't that be crazy if she wins and then they're like, okay, now you get a title shot?
Well, it wouldn't be crazy. I can see. I mean, if
well, no, I'm saying though, if she wins, I think they could. There's a case for a title shot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean,
see, the one knock on Tisha is she really,
dude. Tisha,
she can't bust a grape.
But she's 6-0 as a pro,
oh,
7-0 as an amateur
athlete, and she right. hits.
She's
great technique. She hits.
I felt like she had a
well.
Loss though. How is she 6-0?
She lost in tough, I believe, but that doesn't go against her record.
She won, though, in the UFC debut. Who'd she fight? Beck Rawlins or something?
I don't remember, but I know I think she lost in
she
to
lost
Carla.
In the tough house, yeah.
She, to Carla, I believe. Carla yeah. Esparza, and then I believe that didn't go against her record.
Yeah,
but.
Yeah, and then I guess she won a decision. I get Angela Hill. She just yeah. beat Angela Hill. Yeah.
yeah, so that I
pull
mean
that
that's what I'm saying. Like she's got great technique, but she it doesn't translate into like one punch power in that division. And in that division, if you have one punch power, Jocelyn can put together a knockout. You know, you have an advantage if you have that kind of power in your striking. And Tisha needs to display it if she does have it.
Yeah, yeah, and I'm trying to get my computer to turn on here to see what time it is. In a few minutes, we have Georgie K coming up.
Actually,
oh, wow, 8:43. Wow, we literally do have him in just a few minutes.
We're going pretty quickly. So
yeah, I was going to say we should bring up another topic, but we have him on like literally any minute.
The
so,
insane one.
Man, Bellator 147 coming up. Pretty good card.
Yeah.
You want to call him?
No, he's going to call in.
Oh, okay.
They're doing yeah. good things, man. I don't care what anybody
oh,
says.
I love
everybody
Bellator.
Hates
it's a lot
on
of fun.
Bellator, but they're doing good things.
What do you
we
guys?
We love it.
What do you guys think of Dada, you know,
oh,
versus
yes.
Kimbo? I'm
oh,
excited
man.
About that.
I can't wait.
I don't give a fuck
Can
what anybody says.
Talk about the good things?
No.
Yeah, like Dada versus Kimbo. Yeah, okay, first of all, if you're an internet person like me yeah. and watch Kimbo coming up, you yeah. follow the thread against Gannon,
yeah,
and exactly. who I become friends with and asked about the fight and stuff. And then if you also watch the documentary about Dada, I mean,
yeah, you got to watch it. I mean, to me,
I'm invested.
It's a fight.
I'm invested.
It's a fight. You know,
I think Kimbo's going to knock him the fuck out quick. Kimbo's going to knock him the fuck out.
You know what I love
actually,
about-
Kimbo against Shamrock, Kimbo looked horrible against Shamrock.
But it's a
if
stand-up
Kimbo,
fight.
If Backyard Kimbo comes in.
But yeah, Dada didn't dude. Look so good in his MMA debut.
He looked horrible.
He looked really, he looked gassy.
And Kimbo's got hands.
I know. Kimbo can last. I don't know. We'll see. Kimbo said it's you know, he's been training a lot.
I hope Kimbo microdoses on testosterone, comes in on a six pack, and it's Backyard Kimbo.
Gold teeth.
Well, because in case they test him, you got to microdose now.
I say they go come in full Vitor. You know, just both of
full
them.
Vitor.
Just because it doesn't matter.
True revival touch therapy, isn't that what it's called?
Yeah.
You know, when are they going to ever fight again? I mean, that might be his one and only, right? I mean, who else? If he wins, who's next?
Scott Coker could not have signed him to a multi-fight
yeah.
year, right?
Oh, of course
I mean,
he did.
No
with
way.
Signings and everything.
I mean, this is
and
a one
I don't
and
know
done,
why
right?
we're joking because we like the product and we're good terms with them. And
no,
we think it's
I love
it's a great.
I
am though. The only reason I'm Kim. The only problem with Ken and Hoist is I don't want to see either one lose. I'm fans. Who do you root for? I'm such a huge Shamrock fan. Actually, yeah, I'm rooting for Shamrock. I answered my own question. I'm a huge
Shamrock
fan. I'm such a big. But it's not that I don't like Hoist. But
I was
damn,
torn
I want to
on
see
that,
Ken win
on the Shamrock Kimbo fight. I was torn on, but the Shamrock Gracie fight to me kind of is intriguing because. You know, there are some elder statesmen that I would still like to see get it on, you know?
Exactly.
Like Laborio
like a,
and
not
Sperry.
A
I would love to see them
Masters.
In an MMA fight.
Exactly.
You know, not in a jiu-jitsu match, but a fucking
like
fight.
Like a Masters
yeah.
division. Yeah.
Like they had at Abu Dhabi. Sperry and Laborio went
exactly.
at it in Abu Dhabi. I would love to see those two. Like
those are so
out.
Fun. I mean, why? Yeah. I don't understand. I mean, yeah, it's somewhat of a spectacle, but it's entertainment. And nonetheless,
yeah.
I mean, it's just like, for me, it's like when I used to watch Pride, you know?
Exactly.
I mean,
I love Pride.
Yeah.
You could still find technique in a Masters division.
Of course.
Oh. Oh, we've got a call coming in. I think this is going to be Georgie K.
Boom, boom, boom.
Ladies,
insane one.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Georgie, Aaron's going to introduce you in a second, and you'll be
Actually, Adrian, I love when Adrian answers the phone because he hates talking to people, and this forces him to talk to everyone.
Like, socialize.
It's absolutely great. Ladies and gentlemen, he's the Bellator 147 co-main event this Friday on Spike TV. 24-4-1 record. He is the insane one, Georgie K. Georgie, welcome to the show. This is Aaron, Jonathan King, and Adrian Gallegos. How are you doing tonight?
Good, man. How are you guys doing?
Doing great. Thanks for being on the show. You have a big fight coming up this week. We appreciate your time. How do you feel getting ready for the fight this week?
Oh, I feel great. You know, everything's good. My weight is good. And, you know, just can't wait to step inside that cage on Friday night.
You have you're coming off an injury. Your knee was in bad shape. I know you had surgery. Talk about the recovery process and the length of time it's been. How long it took you to get back on the shtick again, and are we going to see anything different, or is it going to be the same old in your face Georgi Karakhanian
that we love?
Well, you know, the recovery process was, you know, very, very painful. I'm not going to lie, but it was good. You know, I needed that. It was just a little time off. It was a kind of vacation, but it was like a painful vacation, you could say. But you know, it's going to be different, Georgie, for sure. You know, every time I step in there, I'm in your face, but, you know, I'm trying to do different things. I can't just be the same fighter as I was, you know, my last fight, because, you know, I'm not evolving. So, you know, I try to do everything different every fight. So, you know, I might say I'm going to try and knock you out, but I'm going to go for submission, or trying to go for submission and go for knockout. You know, it's going to be a little different and unorthodox.
Yeah, speaking of evolving or changing things, I mean, you were training, you know, with a guy who develops and is the house of champions. You were training with Edmund, but you left. Where did you go, and where are you training now?
You know, first of all, I never actually trained with Edmund. I trained a few times, but I never actually had a camp with Edmund. You know, GFC always had their doors open for me, but I never actually spent time to train there or work on my camps. But, you know, my training place was always Melania, and, you know,
Batista's the man. I love those guys there.
Yeah, and, you know, I had an opportunity to go train with Frankie Edgar because he asked me to go help him for a Uriah Faber fight. So that was an eye-opener. You know,
oh, wow.
With a former lightweight champion. So,
wow, you know, how was that?
That was actually good, man. You know, Frankie pushed me a lot, showed me a lot of stuff. And, you know, I actually get to watch, you know, a high-caliber fighter like Frank Edgar, how he trains. And, you know, spent about a week and a half with him there and lived at his parents' house. And, you know, it was just a great experience.
Now, I'm wondering, how much of this trip to visit Frankie Edgar was you helping him get ready for a camp, and how much of it was you getting his kids ready for soccer? Because I'm always seeing his kids playing soccer on social media, and I know that you were like a freaking professional soccer player, man. So what's going on with that? Any idea that you're going to start going kicking that ball around again?
You know, I never had an opportunity to help Frankie's kids, but, you know, as far as me playing, hell no. I'm not trying to get close to soccer because, you know, someone kicks me in the leg, but a fucking ankle or something happens, you know, I want to be injury free. You know, this knee injury taught me a lot. It taught me how to train smart and, you know, listen to my body, because before I would just train crazy three times a day and just not take any days off. So, you know, just, you got to listen to your body.
Yeah. Speaking of being smart, you're fighting a crafty guy. You're fighting Daniel Wachel. He's 35-9. He's a crafty vet. You know, where do you see this guy being dangerous, and how do you want to finish this guy? How do you want to finish this fight? Because you're pretty much in line for a title shot. This is a co-main event. This is a big-name fighter you're against. And, I mean, you're a champion-level fighter.
Yeah, you know, I don't – to be honest, I don't care who I face. You know, they said my last fight, when I faced Bubba, they're like, oh, I'm going to get taken down. I'm going to get my ass kicked. And, you know, you saw what happened. And, you know – Daniel is just a journeyman. You know, he had a lot of fights under his record. He has a lot of good wins, a lot of good losses, and one of the losses is going to be to me too. So, you know, I know he has not that many holes in his game, but this is MMA, and I haven't seen him change. He's been fighting the same way the whole Bellator tournament, and, you know, even his last fight with Pitbull, he's the same fighter, but he might expect to get ready for, you know, the same Georgie that fought Bubba that's going to go for guillotine. But no, you know, I have different submissions under my skills, and I can't wait to show it on Friday night.
All right, Georgie, I've got to ask you a question. In 2011, you faced Pitbull, and he won by TKO. Well, there was something that happened in the back room at Bellator recently, a few months back, between you and him, supposedly. I asked him what happened, and I'm going to read you his response, and then I want to get your response to this, because he lost the belt, so yeah. I don't know if you even want to fight him still or you want the belt. So let me read this to you. This was his response. I already fought Georgie in 2011. On that occasion, I knocked him out. He was a cool guy. He asked me to train with him after the fight. I accepted because we're professionals in this sport. That's normal. But after Conor McGregor, everyone wants to talk crap. This dude wants to get views talking crap. But with me, that's not how it works. I show who I am inside the cage. He challenged me, talked crap on Twitter, and said he's coming for me. But nothing happened. Then when we were signing posters for Bellator, he walked in and demanded to know why I was looking at him. That's when the conflict started. Everyone saw it. That was translated by Christian Stein. How do you want to respond to that?
All right, so let's go back. After he beat me fair and square, we start exchanging, we start talking, and there was a time where he said, I'm gonna be in San Diego, we're gonna train, and I was willing to train, you know, but the whole scene with all I told him on the Twitter, I said, just keep my belt, you know, just take care of my belt, make sure you don't put no acai stains, you know, Brazilian black meat acai. You know, I didn't say nothing bad, I just fucking said acai, you know. So, and, you know, he took that offensively. I'm not trying to be no Conor McGregor, man. Fuck Conor McGregor, you know. I have this saying, you know, you come to this sport, you either go through the way or you hit the jackpot. Conor McGregor hit the jackpot, and whatever, it's good for him, fuck him. If I see him on the street, I still bitch slap him. So I hate when people try to compare me to him, you know, saying that, oh, I talk shit because of him. No, fuck him. And in regards to the poster signings, Syed was signing posters, and I was trying to keep it professional because it's fight week for Saeed, and I don't want to say anything. When we walked in our room, he was just pacing back and forth, just mad-dogging me. And, I kind of looked at him, and he just started saying things that I can understand, man. I wish I had, I wish I had his home address so I could send him Rosetta Stone so he could learn English. But when he started yelling at me, I didn't understand what he was saying, so I thought he was going to fight in there. And I just forced him, and yeah, he had all his other Brazilian friends behind him, so I thought it was going to be a fight, which, you know, honestly, I don't care. I'm willing to fight anywhere. It's just, I'm a very cool person, but you push the wrong button, I don't care where we're at, you know. Let's do it. So I thought he was going to fight, but he started backing up. You know, he started going back, and then, you know, that's there. You know, he's been a bitch, you know, I have nothing, you know, he wants to, my goal is to get the belt, you know, that's my goal, whoever has the belt, that's what I'm chasing.
Well, so having had that happen to you, were you surprised at all when you heard that they had jumped, I think, Daniel Strauss a few weeks ago?
Yeah, man, that's messed up, you know, you don't do that.
Do you think that's the type of stuff that they would do, though, after what happened with you?
Well, I wish they would do that to me. You know, I don't think they would do that to me or Saeed, you know, because they know what's up. You know, I know the Brazilians, they have... the honest truth is, it's a little man syndrome. He's just little. When he was growing up, you know, he had that syndrome. So I think he just... You know, if he tried to touch me, man, I would have fucked him right in the face. And I don't care.
Let me ask you, how did you get into fighting? Because you just sound... You know how, there's an intangible about a successful fighter. You have to not be arrogant, but you have to be confident. You have to think and know in your head you can take that guy out. Otherwise, there's no way in hell you can be a winner and be a future champion. so I can sense it about you. I'm curious, how did you get into fighting? Were you raised, like, taking martial arts? Is it something you fell into? What's your story?
I think growing up as a kid, I was really aggressive, and I was getting a lot of troubles. When I was playing soccer, I would get a lot of red cards, you know, just getting a fight with players. But, you know, fighting never played in my mind. You know, you're never going to hear me say, oh, yeah, man, when I was born, you know, I saw myself being a professional fighter. It's just something, you know, I was an aggressive kid. I was a little, you know, running around everywhere, just very hyper, and, you know, just, I guess you could say I got an accident. You know, a friend of mine was doing jiu-jitsu, and I fell in love with, you know, jiu-jitsu, the art of jiu-jitsu, and then, you know, from there I started fighting.
All right, cool. Well, we have just a couple more questions because we know it's fight week, and we don't want to take up too much more of your time. So our Jonathan King here is going to ask you a question. Then I'm going to ask you a follow-up one myself.
Where do you see the Bellator division going? The Bellator system, actually, you know, they're partnering up with Ryzen. They're putting on fights like Dada against Kimbo. And they're even doing some hybrid cards that are kickboxing. How do you feel about being on cards that are not pure MMA cards?
And before you answer, I'm going to follow up, so we'll combine our question into one. I was going to say, we love Bellator, the product, what they do, how exciting it is, how they're willing to take chances and risk and put on fights the fans want to see. Also, sponsorships. Do you feel like you have a better opportunity and can be more successful financially and in every aspect right now in Bellator than any other place? And what do you love about Bellator? Or what do you like about Bellator?
Hello?
Oh, crap. I think he hung up when I asked him about the Bellator thing. Hold on one second.
He probably just lost him.
No, I think we lost him. Yeah.
Bad connection. Because it sounded like it was fading out.
Okay, we're calling him back up. If he does, he said 10 minutes, so maybe the timer at 10 minutes went off and he hung up. We had a 10-minute window. No, I'm just kidding.
Hey.
All right, sorry about that. We were just finishing up saying last few questions here. What do you like about Bellator's product and about what Bellator is doing? Because they're just they're not afraid to take chances and take risks. They put on fights fans want to see. They allow you to get sponsorships and to make money outside of the cage and inside of the cage. What do you appreciate and like about the Bellator product?
Lost him again.
Oh, crap. Yeah, I think we lost him. All right, well, I guess we tried our best with Georgie. I still had a lot of fun, and he had some incredible stuff to say.
Must be in a bad area or something.
Ladies and gentlemen, Georgie K.
Georgie Karakhanian, man.
And thank you so much to Bellator for setting that up. I mean, I'll answer the question for him, I guess. The stuff I love about Bellator is that they make it more fan-friendly. It's on one channel. The fighters can wear unique, different things. They have their own sponsors. They get to do fun walkouts. They get to do the entrance. You know, they let the fighter show personality and be themselves.
I think he's calling us back there.
All right, let's try it one more time.
All right, we'll try it one more time.
George, are you there?
Yeah, hold on one second.
Okay. I think he's trying to switch to the Bluetooth.
Are you guys there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, so tell us, what do you like about Bellator and what they allow you to do as a fighter?
You know, as far as Bellator throwing the hybrid shows like kickboxing and mixing with MMA and all that stuff, I think that's great, you know. It shows that we are different than any other promotion out there. And that, you know, you don't want to be, you know, the same type of organization. You know, this is, I think Bellator is totally different than anyone, you know. And as far as the kickboxing, man, I would love to, you know, after this fight, I want to talk to Coker, and hopefully I want to get on one of those kickboxing cards. And,
there you go.
You know, just straight kickboxing.
Wow, but, some breaking news there, huh?
Nice. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, nice.
But, you know, I have a professional boxing fight. You know, I already had one. I'm 1-0, but, you know, I think kickboxing will be way easier than boxing. So I wouldn't mind, you know, fighting and kickboxing. But, and as far as Bellator, you know, I love Bellator, you know. I don't want to be making $1,000 from a Reebok deal like all those UFC guys that are getting screwed. You know, we have the opportunity to all use all this other sponsors. And, you know, they're all coming to Bellator. And I'm just happy, you know. I have a lot, way more sponsors. And I'm gonna make probably way more than any, you know, UFC fighter that's fighting his second or third or fourth fight.
All right. Well, Georgie, everyone who wants to check you out and see you fight, put on a great show for us. It can be seen this Friday night, Bellator 147, co-main event on Spike TV. Georgie, please tell us before we let you go, who has been supporting you and making it possible to train and get ready for this fight?
Yeah, you know, the major support was from South Coast Mitsubishi. You know, they've been supporting me a lot. Hayabusa, they supported me a lot. Garden of Life Nutrition, and who else? There's a lot more. Future Legend, Pain Away, Original Grappler. You know, a lot of those sponsors, you know, stepped up and helped me out. And
yeah, we actually share a sponsor, Georgie.
Yeah, we got some Pain Away right here.
Yeah, we're also sponsored by Pain Away.
Yeah, you should use them, man. It's the best thing.
I have.
Yeah, stuff works.
All right, well, Georgie.
Don't get it close to your balls. Don't get it close
to your balls. Especially the heat. Yeah.
Or touch your eyes. Hey, Georgie, I already have obviously followed your career, but I didn't really know too much about you on a personal level. After this interview, I am now a big fan, and I cannot wait to see your fight. Ladies and gentlemen, check out Georgie, Bellator 147, co-main event this Friday, Spike TV. Thank you so much for the time. Ladies and gentlemen, Georgie K.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for being on the show.
Dude, that guy is you know, take away the top 10 best fighters. In my eyes, in the 145-pound division, he is a top 4 fighter that I want to see fight. Every time he fights, it's fucking entertaining.
24-4-1? That's a fucking lot of wins. That's a lot of wins.
He's saying that he's evolved and he's changed his game, but I can't see him being any less aggressive than he's always been.
He has that switch. It's like where I was walking a fine line during the interview. I didn't want to like say something the wrong thing and for him to get pissed off or upset. I could see he had that Armenian rush and just that temper. But oh my God, man, he has some cool stories. And thanks again to Bellator for setting that up for us. We really appreciate it. And I can't wait for the fights this weekend. And Josh Thompson, the main event, the Punk. It's going to be a good card.
Yeah, Thompson is a guy that I thought the UFC kind of did wrong.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you, these guys are better off going to Bellator and being a champ or a winning prize fighter. And having sponsors and being, you know, the guy that everyone pays to see. Yeah. Then being a bottom-level guy in the UFC getting fucked on decisions or getting bad draws, getting bad fights.
Everybody says Thompson got fitched. And the thing about...
I disagree.
He left on his own terms.
The thing about
he
Fitch was...
He couldn't even wear his own brand, his Fitch own gym.
Exactly. Fitch was getting paid $75,000 to lay on top of somebody and be in the top 5 and not take chances. So the UFC cut him when he was still viable.
I think Thompson had one of those good contracts from AKA Strikeforce.
Yeah, but Thompson's fights are always entertaining. Right. Win or lose, he's like Karakhanian. They're fucking always entertaining. You're going to have a good fight with Thompson. What was it, Thompson-Henderson?
Oh, and I remember that he got screwed on that, but then the head kick against Diaz.
Yeah. I mean, every single time. And I talked to Josh Thompson at World Series of Fighting, and I was like, one more win, and I can't see him denying you a title shot. I said that to him backstage, and he said, John, I will never get a title shot in the UFC. And I was like, why not? And he goes, they don't want a 38-year-old champion.
What? That's crazy.
They don't want a 38-year-old champion. That's what his words to me backstage at World Series of Fighting was.
Are you on record?
On record, yes.
Say it one more time.
They don't want a 38-year-old champion.
Cease and desist.
Josh is the perfect example of like the guys in the UFC that got screwed from the Reebok deal. I mean, he's probably making at least $50,000. And
those guys up in that area, that dethrone money.
The dethrone,
you, that
original
dethrone.
Grappler. Remember the OG sponsorship and Knox. I think was the one.
That technology, Oak Grove technology.
Oak Grove. That's
even
Oak
the
Grove,
fact
yeah.
that we know the names of these fucking companies.
Well, those are all Zinkin.
It's money well worth.
Those
in
are
my
all
opinion.
Yeah, like the Zinkin boys all have the same sponsors. You know, the Zinkin Entertainment.
And
guys.
Dethrone's owned by Zappos.com. Those people.
Yeah.
So it's.
Yeah,
no, I think Koscheck's got a piece of that too, doesn't he?
Apparently, he's living
part
in that guy's house or something.
No, he's part owner.
Car.
He's part owner
of Dethrone.
Yeah, I think Koscheck is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Koscheck's long money, dude. Yeah. He's not short money. He's long money.
Is Koscheck still in the UFC?
He's in Bellator.
Bellator.
He's Bellator. Yeah. Right?
He's
yeah.
fighting
dude,
on the Coker's same night as
the Daily.
Dude,
getting all the AKA guys back. Yeah, it's basically Strikeforce 2.0. I love it.
Imagine if they get Benson. If they can get Benson,
I think Benson's going to Ryzen. I really do.
Oh, because
but
what?
That's a one-off.
Yeah,
it's in 2 weeks.
He could make hundreds of thousands.
It's a one-off in 2 weeks. What is this guy talking about?
I see him announcing that he's signed at that one, at the New Year's Eve.
For what event? And then what does he do in the meantime?
Because they said they're doing four events.
He's more marketable in that
four
area
events this year.
Because he's of his background.
Who did?
Ryzen.
Or Bellator.
No, Ryzen said they're going to do four events this year.
Wow.
Yeah.
This
and,
year?
And Bob Sapp's going to headline co-main event. It's going to be Bob Sapp headlining co-main event.
That's
Benson
what I said.
Anderson.
They signed Bob Sapp, and he's not on this card. You know?
Are you sure?
They signed Bob Sapp?
Well, they haven't announced the full card yet. He is on this card. He's fighting. They
announced
his opponent,
too. Okay, that's right.
This
you
guy,
text me.
Ladies
that's
and gentlemen,
right.
this guy doesn't even know.
Sorry about that.
All right, Adrian, what do you guys do for Thanksgiving?
For Thanksgiving? Oh, man. It's been a while. I went up to Barstow to see my family. My wife's family, rather. Anyways, we went to go shoot guns as usual. But one thing we always do every year is all the guys, we play cards and we drink till like 5 in the morning. Ooh, I ended up drinking
fun.
A bottle of tequila by myself.
It's good
That's
work.
It's crazy. You never see me drink that much. Aaron's seen me.
I don't see you ever even drink hard liquor. I don't think I've ever seen you take a shot.
Yeah, I drank a whole bottle of tequila. It was fun. We were playing cards all night. And the next morning, I went shooting all day. It's a great gun club out there. It was a lot of fun. That's pretty much all I
Cool.
did.
What about you, Clinch? Were you out of town or?
No, I went down to my partner John
Walsh's
house in Irvine, hung out with him and his baby. A couple buddies came over and we just had a nice turkey and hung out, laid low.
Yeah. I like being by myself, so it kind of sucked. It was annoying. Had to be around family and people.
You were with your family, weren't you?
Was or wasn't?
You were.
Some of them, yeah, but I didn't enjoy it. You know, I don't like holidays and I like being by myself.
Hold on, Adrian. It's been a while since we've been in studio.
Yeah.
Oh, I want to hear some Tapatios.
I've got some horrible
Tapatio time.
I've got some horrible ones. Don't say
That's your segment, dude.
I think someone's don't say anything, please, about when I texted you about something. I texted him about the Tapatio situation a few weeks ago.
Saturday night, I'm waiting for a text from Aaron now. I'm out drinking.
What, did you guys have plans to do something? Or?
No.
Like for me to ask him for some crazy scenario.
Oh, my God. You were fishing for help?
Yeah.
Did you add one on the line or no?
He fucking doesn't have any advice worth a shit. This guy's been dating the same lady for 12 years, and I'm asking him advice for hooking up with chicks.
What did you tell him? Say, like, donde está?
He just says the same bullshit
every time. Bateria.
No. This time I told him no Tapatio bullshit, and he just says the same thing every time where he goes, just hook up with the one you're with, and the rest will follow. And that never works. Oh, Jesus.
I'll give you advice. When you call Adrian and text him at after he's had a few drinks.
Yeah.
Okay, speaking of crazy
Do the exact opposite of what
guys,
he tells you.
This is kind of copying Joe Rogan. I heard it on a show. He was talking about it. Have either of you ever had sex with a bald woman?
Oh, yeah, I heard about that. No, I haven't.
Shaved head.
Yeah.
Shaved
bald
head.
Bald woman.
Not bald, but like crew cut.
Either by choice or not, have you ever had sex with a bald woman?
No.
No.
Okay, I have, of course.
Of course.
It wouldn't be me if it wasn't. So I didn't know she was bald, and we had been on a few dates. I shouldn't even tell this story.
Did she have a hat?
Yes. You know those beanies? Like, it was winter. You know those beanie hats that have the little brim on them?
Yeah.
Oh, she wore those hats?
Yeah, like every time, even inside. And I was like, whatever, her style. It's the trendy thing. It's winter, whatever. So finally it progresses to the point where we make it to the bedroom a few days later. And I run my hand through her hair and the hat comes off. And
it's your skin?
How big was her cock?
It was... No. I knew she was a cancer survivor. She was a cancer survivor. She had cancer. Dude, she had cancer. She was a woman. Believe me. She was a woman. That's a different story I told you about where I think it was a guy.
You're a dick, Adrian.
I'm fucking asshole.
You're a All right, dick.
So anyways, so I was thinking about that just because Joe Rogan brought it up the other day, and I was like, I did, but not on purpose.
Did you hear about Joe Rogan's feeble apology that he made?
I didn't hear the apology, but...
Hold on, let him finish the story about the girlfriend.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
The bald, focus,
the
focus.
Bald one?
Yeah.
Oh, well, she's a cancer survivor, and I was like, what the fuck? She's like, oh, you didn't know I was bald? And I was like, and she goes, you didn't know I had cancer? And I'm like, you said you survived. I didn't know you fucking still had it or that. Like, and
she survived Aaron True as well.
No, actually, to be honest, we're still like great friends, and she's really cool. She's like my friend.
So did you do a doggy style like Joe Rogan said? You know,
I can't remember the exacts, but let's just say that it was just interesting because I wasn't expecting it. I don't want to get any more because she's a really nice person.
But is there any positions that you thought? Well,
yes, exactly what Joe said. Yes,
really?
Exactly. Like, yes.
Like you
yes.
started to think like, well, maybe like
it was strange.
This is what.
We should just do our podcast like on everything that Joe Rogan talks about. I want to do the Joe Rogan after show.
I do want to I want to, without even telling him, to start doing it.
We should get like just, a big Joe Rogan poster for the studio. The unofficial Joe Rogan.
It's
gonna be the Joe Rogan companion.
Exactly. Do you want? Are you down to start it? Can I come here and film him? Can I come here and film him for now, Adrian? Can I come here and do this?
Joe Rogan, could you please come on our show? Would you ever grace us with your presence?
He made a video telling me not to film videos anymore.
The God of Rogan?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
I think actually, though, that we should just do the wrap-up Joe Rogan show.
Funny enough, that's when I started to listen to Joe Rogan, it was because he mentioned one of our interviews. That's when I first started.
Me too, actually.
Yeah, yeah. That's the reason why we started listening to it.
So. I want to go Bigfoot hunting with Joe Rogan and Bobo.
Oh, Joe hates now Bigfoot, thinks it's bullshit. Don't you, JRE, bro?
Me, Joe Rogan, Bobo from the Bigfoot research team, a huge sack of reefer.
Speaking of a huge sack of reefer, let's get the weed segment of the week. Okay. Medical marijuana.
Yeah, here you go, Age. You want the...
And then we'll hit one more topic and then get out of here.
One more topic, Tio. Oh. So
what is it?
Here we go. Okay, this week's strain of the week.
Oh, Lord, I can smell that from here.
Once again for our boys at VMC. By the way, VMC is not closed. Their store shut down, but they're still doing deliveries, and their new store opens tomorrow on La Brea, I believe. La Brea and Pico in Los Angeles. So check them out. This is Skywalker OG. Indica, very strong indica.
Smells incredible.
It's a, the bud itself is a little bit dry, so it kind of lost a point because of the it's not too fresh. But its primary use, as everybody knows, I use it for pain for my leg. It's really, really good, though. Very strong. I give it about a 8.6 out of 10. I would use it at night, only at night, because if you use it at daytime, it's going to become nighttime.
So what was it on the scale 1 to 10?
I'd say about an 8.7, 8.6 out of 10. And it's a strong piney taste, really good flavor. After show, I'll be sampling it in the after show on Periscope, so make sure you check us out. And I got it from VMC Collective, which used to be on Venice but now is on Pico and La Brea. So go see the boys at VMC. You can check them out on Weed Maps.
All right, well, hopefully people heard that kind of low voice.
Oh, did I not do it too good? Yeah. I'll do it in a pirate voice next time.
All right,
it's the best weed in town.
All right, so any last burning... Okay, we never... Screw it, we can go a few minutes long. We'll talk.
Let's go long. It's been a while,
we're
going
to release segments anyway, and people can listen to the whole show if they
want.
It's
been a while.
Okay, well, the last thing here. My documentary, Netflix Pick of the Week. I'm not even a big... Nirvana person.
Oh my god, I watched it.
Soaked in bleach.
Yes,
incredible. Soaked in bleach. Courtney Love. They paint the picture that Courtney Love and her current lover killed Kurt Cobain. That her lover killed Kurt Cobain. And you're paying
attention to the bullshit fucking conspiracy theory. I thought you were talking about how hot the actress that played Courtney Love was. I wanted to fuck her.
Oh my god, you went full potato. This guy just went full potato. This is the best documentary I've ever seen in years.
It is the most ridiculous thing in the world.
Are you kidding me? The private detective that she hired thought she was so shady, he started investigating her. The police never did the proper investigation. Everything points to her. They were in the middle of a divorce, and he had a prenup. If they got divorced, she got nothing. He killed her as they were separated. They both were in different relationships.
Can I point something out? And the documentary touches on this? You're talking about this whole thing is hinged on a private investigator who, by the way, recorded his own client and used that shit against them, which fucking makes you shady as hell. But second of all, isn't that illegal? He walked past the room that Kurt Cobain was in for 4 fucking days and didn't look in it. And then when they asked him, he was like,
dark
and raining. I didn't see it.
It was
right
dark and
in
raining.
Front of you.
He wasn't familiar with the property.
Oh, come on. There's a window and a balcony right in front of where
the
he parked his car.
The guy giving the tour said, I have to talk to Courtney first. And had specific instructions. Then he said, oh, no, this is it. There's nothing else. Knowing damn well that that was a room they should have looked at.
I'm just not buying it, dude. I thought it was kind of...
I haven't seen it. I want to see it, though.
It's called... Basically, they prove... They prove within a shadow of a doubt.
I'm convinced.
Basically, the police is going to reopen this investigation and investigate Courtney Love.
The only thing that they prove is that Courtney Love was on tape talking about how she should make more money off of Kurt being disappeared. Maybe we should hold it off from the press because I have an album coming out next week, and you know,
okay,
I could probably make more money.
The shotgun he was found killed with
He bought it
that
week.
This is not in his name. Someone else bought it.
Oh, his best friend Dylan or whatever.
And then the way the forensics, the gun was found upside down, there's no way possible he could have shot himself with the way it was.
Yeah, the ejection port, the gun doesn't turn. But I looked online and they said that shotguns can turn on a self-inflicted gunshot.
How many times have you shot a shotgun?
Twice.
Adrian, how often do you shoot shotguns?
I shot a lot. I shot 300 rounds this last Saturday.
How often have you shot a shotgun upside down with your thumb?
How many times have you shot a shotgun where the shell went off out the other side?
Oh, it's impossible.
Thank you.
If you had the butt of the gun like this and you're pulling the trigger,
it's impossible.
Wouldn't matter.
Why? The thing's a pirouette. It's on one point.
Because it's so fast. It's way too fast. And the amount of power that it takes when it goes that way, first of all, more than anything, right? So it's not going to go. You can't.
Wait, hold on a second. And then,
yeah.
A shell doesn't even inject from a shotgun unless you pump it, though, does it?
If it's semi-auto, then it automatically.
Oh, it had to be a semi-auto then.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. If it's semi-auto, you know what's funny is I haven't watched this documentary, but
it's incredible. Gosh darn it!
That exact question I was trying to do this weekend because I was noticing my friend would shoot and he would pump it and try to catch the shell. You know, I was like, oh, that's pretty fucking cool, right?
That's what that's called a assassin style.
Yeah. So what I was trying to do is I was trying to shoot and catch the shell
as
well.
But that's hot as hell. Will burn your hand.
No, that's not that. No. You know what?
I'll give you this, Aaron. I thought there was
because you know what the over unders when they pop them, that's exactly what they do. When they open them up and crack them open, they catch them every single time because they reload them. Right?
I've been hit by a shell from a from a handgun.
Those are different.
Okay, shell burns the fuck. Even an AR shell hurts.
Shotgun is plastic. It's not
brass.
That's
iron. Oh, okay. That's hot iron.
Okay, yeah. Well, never mind. Yeah. Okay.
But I agree. There was some things in the documentary that were like. Especially like when they were playing the Courtney Love tapes and she was talking about money. You're like, you fucking greedy bitch. You know, what? Your husband's missing.
And she was so strung out on drugs and alcohol that she didn't know what was going on.
So I definitely agree there was some shady shit, but I'm not buying it because, listen, man, I had someone in my family commit suicide and it's a devastating thing. It's a horrible thing. And it's not something that like... You know, kind of warrants that conspiracy to it's not necessary. You know, he was obviously depressed.
He was not depressed. I mean, that's what everyone said he was not depressed.
I mean, there was I saw an interview with Dave Grohl not too long after he died, and Dave Grohl was saying, you know, he's had issues with depression and
he was trying to quit heroin.
Yeah, and he knew Dave Grohl knew him better than Courtney Love.
Okay,
Dave,
well, how do they explain, how does he have like 20 times the amount of heroin?
That's one of the things that fucking.
And then shot himself? That's not humanly possible.
Well, I have a friend whose younger brother OD'd, and he OD'd after he got out of rehab.
So did my best friend, the tattoo I have right here, and Bradley Noel style. He did the same dose he normally did, but it wasn't 25 fucking times.
That's what I was going to say. That dosage is really high. And unless it was the type of situation where he's like, fuck it, I'm just going to shoot it all and then
He would have to like, it would have to been, I don't think it's, I don't know if he could shoot himself fast enough by the time he took the shot.
I don't know about heroin, but
well, they touched on it. They said his motor functions would have been all fucked up immediately, and he wouldn't have been able to physically shoot himself.
I mean, even if it's a good amount of heroin, right? Let's just say it's concentrated.
They said it was like enough to kill a horse.
Yeah, I watched Jerry Garcia fucking play killer riff after killer riff on fucking heroin. So you can do a lot of good shit on heroin.
I mean, they also built up a tolerance too. So who knows?
There was some stuff that I believed in, some of it that wasn't. It was definitely an interesting documentary. If you have Netflix, check it out.
Thank you. That's all I was asking. So you believe it's true. I believe it's true.
I have another recommendation. I'm not sure if it's a documentary. It's an older movie that somebody recommended, one of my Brazilian coaches, Omar. And he said you should watch this movie about Bope. You know, the SWAT team of Brazil.
Oh yeah, Cordero told me to watch that too.
It's amazing. It's
that's like I think in Brazil that's like their favorite movie. Everyone from Shootabox are kings. They always talk about that movie.
Well, let me tell you about it. First of all, the guy who's the main character is the same guy from Narcos. So that's what made me want to watch it. That's where they got. And it's the same director from Narcos. So, yeah, Wagner Moura is the main actor, but it's the same director from Narcos that did that movie.
I remember them telling me that. I'm like, don't the police? And they're like, oh, man, if the police come, you're fucking. You make the police come out, they're going to fuck someone up.
Well,
someone.
I mean, I don't want to spoil it, but basically.
They don't come for normal crimes.
It's a cool movie because it kind of gives you some insight. It's kind of like Children of God. But it's a little bit more. There's more drama. There's a bit. It's a more of a storyline, and it's kind of cool because the guy's narrating the same way he does on Narcos. So you know, it's kind of hard to switch from movie to a movie. But basically, it just goes over Bope, and it goes over what it takes to be that position. But you know what I was thinking about? Isn't it Thiago is part of Bope, right?
Tavares, one of them.
No,
right?
Thiago Silva. It's Damian Maya.
It's Paulo Thiago.
Jesus,
there
Adrian.
There we go.
It's Anderson Aldo.
We sound like Reebok right now.
Yeah,
it's the Mauler. Anderson Aldo.
That's the newest Reebok jersey. Thiago Silva.
Now we know how Reebok designs their jerseys.
Paulo Thiago Silva.
Netflix is huge, dude. Like in the past 3 years, Netflix has got to be like the number one company, and ISIS is like number two.
I gotta say, they're going down. Netflix is losing a lot of their contracts. As a matter of fact,
Pitt
just did a movie for them, or he's doing a show for them.
Well,
too.
they're making their own original. Brad Pitt. They're making their own original content, but some of the movie rights that they had that were distributing for a while. As a matter of fact, there's like a website now that says what movies are being released. I think some of these like classics are no longer going to be on Netflix. So, I don't know.
All right. Well, anyways, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for listening to the show tonight. Before we finish, just want to say thanks to our sponsor, Edwards Industry, for these custom mugs, custom cups. Thank you very much.
Awesome mugs.
We appreciate and love them. Yeah. And welcome back to the show. We'll be on entimports.com. You can catch the segments. You can catch the full show. Kind of sporadic tonight. Just having fun, hanging out. Guy show. Beer of the week. Weed of the week. Jacked on coffee. Adult film entertainers. UFC fighters.
Smoky beer.
Bellator fighters. TV star from Kingdom, Jonathan King.
He's such a dick.
He's going to be a union actor. Do you hear about what happened? No. He's been on so many episodes, and I'm not going to say what it is because I promised him I wouldn't. Let's just say he may have been upgraded from a grease guy, and now he's going to have to be in the union.
Yeah.
I'll leave it at that.
I may have to rat yourself out and ruin it,
but let's just say...
I got to tell you, though.
I'm going to tell you what it is. This is what he's doing.
Oh, wait.
You'll never believe this, dude. So, Clinch, he gets to.
I'm the jizz mopper. Yeah. No, actually, Kingdom is free. Season one is free on iTunes. If you guys haven't watched the show, Kingdom DirecTV Audience, it's created by Byron Belasco. Absolutely amazing show. I'm not just saying it because I was a guest. I was watching it before I was on it.
He's not just saying that because he's on every episode hanging out with Kenny Florian.
Dude, I'll tell you.
By the way, tell Kenny to come on the show, please.
Oh, God, I would love to.
Tell the guy to answer a goddamn tweet.
Nick Jonas is up for an award for being on this show. I'll tell you, the one thing I'll tell you, in a few episodes ago, Nick Jonas gets in the fight, and it's the best fight choreography I've ever seen in any like mixed martial arts, that movie Warrior, all of them. It's Joe Stevenson.
Even the chick fight movie that just came out?
Fight Valley?
Oh, I heard that.
Fight Valley, yeah.
Is that good?
I heard it's good.
Yeah.
It's so good that they're doing another movie, the director, and he signed Felice Herrig to star in it that they're doing.
Oh, really?
Cold.
Is that the same company?
It's called Cold, I think.
Well, they already did the face-off with Holly Holm and Misha Tate in that movie.
And Cyborg and Holly Holm, too.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
Supposedly... Bitch Correa or whatever his name.
Yeah, she's already calling out Misha.
Yeah,
I'm calling out Misha right now too. So I'm gonna call out Misha right now.
Well, we should get Misha on the show.
Yeah, that's what I want to.
We
call
had someone
about.
Call out Caraway.
I'm calling out Misha right now. Misha, today I was cleaning out my office and I found a picture. It's from Misha and it says to Aaron, "Thank you for being a good and loyal friend." Yet my good and loyal friend won't answer a goddamn direct message on Twitter.
You know what we
do? I said today to her, come on the show to call at Betch or Holly or make a case, whatever you want, promote whatever you want. Come on the show tonight.
Right.
No response. Misha, we love you. We're a huge fan. We support WMMA. We're not here to make you look bad or do anything. We're fans of you, and I'm a fan of freaking Caraway. I was at Misha's, my first ever interview at Strike, my first ever big fight ever covering was Strikeforce Gilbert versus Josh 1, 2009, I think. The first fight was Misha versus Elena Maxwell. That was my first ever post-fight as she left the cage in the freaking tunnel before she went backstage. Caraway fought that night, interviewed him. I've known them since the start pretty much of their career. Come on the damn show, Misha.
Or we'd like you know, Brutally Honest style, we'll just get a porn star that looks like Misha.
Oh my God, that's okay. Misha, ultimatum. You can be Paige Van Zandt and ignore us, and we'll have to get a lookalike or come on the show.
Can I get her right now? Ready? Yeah. I'll get her right now.
You have to do Misha, some research.
Misha, if you don't come on the show, we'll just have to get Ronda Rousey to come on the show.
Oh.
This guy knows nothing about saying obtainable, realistic things. He could have said, Amanda.
Ronda will come on if we ask her.
Yeah.
She answers our direct messages.
Yeah. This guy fucking walks by her at the beach and she doesn't even say hi. He lives in the same neighborhood and she doesn't even say hello.
No, I actually, I've had
very Did she little, walk right
very
by
little
you
dealings with her. And I'm,
I thought
I'm
you guys
her,
ate lunch together.
And I'm in her fight camp all the time, too, which is weird.
So he's, Ronda, we have a member of your fight camp. Right here, Jonathan King.
No, we don't.
We have a self-proclaimed member of your fight camp.
I said I'm
a fellow, actor.
Yes, Ronda, we have a star of Kingdom.
And I was given a gold ear by Uncle Gene LaBelle, too. Oh, wow. So
I saw him wear it on a photo from Kingdom.
Trifecta.
See, we're all hooked up. Man.
Ronda, I know that you need to work on striking. He also trained at ATT.
Yeah, I did.
Sure, he's certified like GIMP, and he's currently going to lawsuit because he's basically... If you see this guy walk, you know he's a cripple. Are you willing to train Ronda?
At what? Being a fucking pothead loser? Yeah, come on over.
You're calling her that?
No, me. Oh. What am I going to train her at? She's a freaking Olympic MMA.
You're in the fucking... same camp already?
Oh, yeah.
This is going south. All right, let's wrap it up.
I interview her training partners.
All right, so anyways, ladies and gentlemen, the Brutally Honest Show. Thanks for listening.